Laudator Jesus Christus, and welcome to the live broadcast here from Panama City of the liturgy presided over by Pope Francis in the Cathedral Basilica of Santa Maria l'Antigua, in which we will also participate in the rite for the dedication of the altar. Present for today's liturgy are priests, religious, and members of lay movements. Welcome to the program. On behalf of Vatican Media, welcome to all of you who are joining us through various Vatican Media outlets, perhaps the Vatican Audio app, the Vatican News web portal, or the YouTube channel, as well as to all of you joining us through Catholic Faith Network, Net TV, Shalom World TV, Salt and Light TV, WTN, Catholic TV, and CBS News. And also a warm welcome goes out to all of you who are joining us through various radio stations throughout the world or other internet sources. My name is Sister Bernadette, and I will be providing for you today the English translation and some commentary. This celebration is taking place within Pope Francis' 26th apostolic journey. It is not officially a part of World Youth Day. We're in the Cathedral Basilica Santa Maria la Antigua, which is the episcopal seat of the Archdiocese of Panama. Construction began in 1608 and was completed in 1716. And it is a colonial monument. The image and the devotion to Santa Maria la Antigua came with the first settlers in 1510, brought from Seville. It was the first devotion to reach the Isthmus of Panama with the arrival of Vasco Núñez de Balboa, who had promised Our Lady to name a town after her if they were able to win a battle. In 1513, Pope Leo X created the first diocese in the New World and gave it the name Santa Maria la Antigua. Panama City was founded on August 15, 1519, and eventually the seat of the diocese was moved there. On September 9th in the year 2000, that was the Jubilee Holy Year under John Paul II, the Episcopal Conference of Panama officially proclaimed Santa Maria la Antigua the patroness of the Republic of Panama. And the following year, in February 2001, the Congregation for Divine Worship, in virtue of the faculties granted by John Paul II, accepted the request of the Archbishop of Panama and confirmed Santa Maria la Antigua as the patroness before God of the Republic of Panama. And not too long ago, 2014, following a request from the Panamanian Bishops Conference, the Congregation for Divine Worship and the Discipline of the Sacraments conferred on the cathedral the title of Minor Basilica. Today we will be witnessing the consecration of the altar, and as with all sacraments and other rites in the church, we will be able to understand a bit both through the proclamation of the Word of God that we will be hearing, as well as by the gestures and the things that are used throughout the rite. Prior to coming here this morning, our Holy Father met with two groups of young people. He met with a delegation of 40 young Polish pilgrims on a cruise throughout the world. On the occasion of the World Youth Day in Panama, the name of the group is A Gift for Young People. They're also celebrating the centenary of the reconquest of independence, one, as we know, in 1918, even though momentarily. Our Holy Father thanked them for the beautiful initiative that they had began and were doing. The group arrived in Panama on the 22nd of January. And then before arriving here at the cathedral, before Mass, the Holy Father greeted a group of young people from France, accompanied by the vicar of the Archdiocese of Paris. So our Holy Father making sure that he greets various groups of young people while he's here. And now we prepare ourselves to participate in this Mass. It is a Mass proper to the dedication of an altar. And the hymn that we are hearing comes from one of the Psalms.
Estén con todos ustedes en la Santa Iglesia de Dios.
And now we move into the blessing of the water. Beloved brothers and sisters, we have gathered here with joy to dedicate a new altar by celebrating the Lord's sacrifice. Let us join in these sacred rites with fervent hearts, listening to God's word with faith and sharing joyfully at the Lord's table. Let us raise our hearts toward the blessed hope. As we come together at one altar, we draw near to Christ, the living stone, in whom we grow into a holy temple. But first, let us humbly call upon God that in His kindness he may be pleased to bless this water He has created, with which we are to be sprinkled. As a sign of repentance and a remembrance of baptism, and by which the new altar will be purified. O God, through whom every creature comes forth into the light of life, you accompany all people with such great love that not only do you nourish them with fatherly care, but you mercifully cleanse them of their sins with the dew of charity and constantly lead them back to Christ the Head. For in your merciful plan, you established that those who descend as sinners into the sacred waters to die with Christ should rise free from guilt and be made His members, heirs with Him to an eternal reward. Sanctify, therefore, with your blessing, this water you have created that, sprinkled on us and on this new altar, it may be a sign of the cleansing waters of salvation in which we have been washed in Christ and made a temple of your Spirit. Grant that with all our brothers and sisters who will celebrate the divine mysteries at this altar, we may come at last to the heavenly Jerusalem. The Holy Father will now bless the new altar with the water that has just been blessed. this case, the altar, which we see now, which will be dedicated, receiving a blessing of the Holy Father. Before we continue with the liturgy,
Dios Padre de Misericordia, a quien dedicamos este nuevo altar.
May God, the Father of Mercies, to whom we dedicate this new altar on earth, grant us remission of sins and allow us to offer the sacrifice of praise for all eternity at his altar on high. O God, who willed to draw all things to your Son, lifted high on the altar of the cross, fill your church, we pray, with heavenly grace, as she dedicates to you this altar, the table at which you will plentifully nourish the faithful you gather as one, and will shape day by day through the outpouring of the Spirit a people consecrated to yourself. We now move into the Liturgy of the Word. We will hear three readings today taken from the votive mass for the dedication of the altar, the first from the Book of Maccabees.
Lectura del primer libro de los Macabeos. El día 25 del mes noveno.
In the 25th of the ninth month, Chislev, in the year 148, the priests rose at dawn and offered a lawful sacrifice on the new altar of holocausts which they had made. The altar was dedicated to the sound of zithers, harps, and cymbals at the same time of year and on the same day on which the pagans had originally profaned it. The whole people fell prostrate in adoration, praising to the skies him who had made them so successful. For 8 days they celebrated the dedication of the altar, joyfully offering holocausts, communion sacrifices, and thanksgivings. They ornamented the front of the temple with crowns and bosses of gold, repaired the gates and the storerooms, and fitted them with doors. There was no end to the rejoicing among the people, and the reproach of the pagans was lifted from them. Judas, with his brothers and the whole assembly of Israel, made it a law that the days of the dedication of the altar should be celebrated yearly at the proper season for 8 days, beginning on the 25th of the month Chislev, with rejoicing and gladness.
Lleguemos hasta el Señor dándole gracias. Lleguemos.
Let us come before the Lord giving thanks. Ring out your joy to the Lord. Hail the rock who saves us. Let us come before him giving thanks with songs. Let us hail the Lord. Mighty God is the Lord, a great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, the heights of the mountains are his. To him belongs the sea, for he made it, and the dry land shaped by his hands.
Lleguemos hasta el Señor dándole gracias.
Let us bow and bend low. Let us kneel before the God who made us. For he is our God, and we, the people who belong to his pasture, the flock that is led by his hand. Our second reading this morning from the letter to the Hebrews.
Lectura de la carta a los Hebreos. Jesucristo es el mismo ayer, hoy y siempre.
Jesus Christ is the same today, yesterday, and forever. Do not let yourselves be led astray by all sorts of strange doctrines. It is better to rely on grace for inner strength than on dietary laws which have done no good to those who kept them. We have our own altar from which those who serve the tabernacle have no right to eat. The bodies of the animals whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest for the atonement of sin are burnt outside the camp.
Son quemados fuera del campamento. De la misma manera, para santificar al pueblo con su sangre.
So too, Jesus suffered outside the gate to sanctify the people with his own blood. Let us go to him then outside the camp and share his degradation. For there is no eternal city for us in this life, but we look for one in the life to come. Through him, let us offer God an unending sacrifice of praise, a verbal sacrifice that is offered every time we acknowledge his name. With which the Book of the Gospels will be venerated. And the deacon now receives the blessing from the Holy Father as the choir chanted the Gospel acclamation. The Father seeks true worshipers to worship him in spirit and in truth, says the Lord. Ourselves to listen to the Holy Gospel according to St. John.
El Señor esté con ustedes.
Y con su espíritu.
Lectura del Santo Evangelio según San Juan. En aquel tiempo llegó Jesús a un pueblo de Samaria llamado Sicar.
At that time,
cerca del campo en que Jacob a su
hijo, the Samaritan woman said to Jesus,
allí estaba el pozo.
I see you are a prophet, sir.
Jesús, que venía cansado del
Our
camino,
fathers worshipped.
Se sentó sin más en el brocal del pozo. Era cerca del mediodía. Entonces llegó una mujer samaritana a sacar agua. La mujer le dijo a Jesús, Señor, ya veo que eres un
profeta. The Samaritan woman said to Jesus, I see you are a prophet, sir. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, while you say that Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship. Jesus said, believe me, woman, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know. For salvation comes from the Jews. But the hour will come. In fact, it is already here, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. That is the kind of worshiper the Father wants. God is spirit, and those who worship must worship in spirit and truth.
Palabra del Señor.
Gloria a ti, Señor
Jesús. And our Holy Father now being helped down the steps in order to arrive at the podium, and we prepare ourselves to hear his homily.
En primer lugar, quiero felicitar al señor arzobispo, que por primera vez después de casi 7 años puede encontrarse con su esposa, con esta iglesia.
For the first time,
viuda promisoria
after 7 years,
y felicitar a la viuda que deja de ser viuda hoy con el encuentro con su esposo.
And he's saying that his he's no longer a widow because after this, because of the idea that the bishop is married to the local church, he will have his bride back. He wants to thank everyone, for all who have made everything possible, and also the people of God, everything that you've done.
Con su pueblo, no en casa prestada, sino en la suya. Muchas gracias.
So that the Archbishop will now be able to welcome him properly into his own home.
El programa estaba previsto que esta ceremonia,
program that was foreseen,
por falta de tiempo,
ceremony,
tuviera dos significados, la consagración del altar
y el
meanings, encuentro con
the consecration of the altar, the dedication of the altar, and a meeting with priests, religious, and the consecrated laity. So what I will say will follow, and I will speak to priests and religious and consecrated lay, especially to those who work in this particular church in Panama.
Era la hora del mediodía.
Jacob's well was there, and so Jesus, wearied as he was with his journey, sat down beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. There came a woman of Samaria to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." The gospel we have heard does not shrink from showing us Jesus wearied from his journey. At midday, when the sun makes all its strength and power felt, we encounter him beside the well. He needed to relieve and quench his thirst, to refresh his steps, to recover his strength in order to continue his mission. The disciples personally experienced the extent of the Lord's commitment and readiness to bring the good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to captives and freedom to prisoners, to comfort those who mourned, and to proclaim a year of favor to all. These are all situations that consume life and energy, yet they show us many important moments in the life of the Master, moments in which our humanity too can find a word of life. Weary from the journey. It is relatively easy for us, compulsively busy as we are, to imagine and enter into communion with the Lord's activity. Yet, we do not always know how to contemplate and accompany his weariness. It seems this is not something proper to God. The Lord knew what it was to be tired, and in his weariness, so many struggles of our nations and peoples, our communities, and all who are weary and heavily burdened can find a place. There are many reasons for weariness on our journey as priests, consecrated men and women, and members of lay movements. From long hours of work which leave little time to eat, rest, and be with family. Toxic working conditions and relationships that lead to exhaustion and disappointment. From simple daily commitments to the burdensome routine of those who do not find the relaxation, appreciation, or support needed to move from one day to the next. From the usual and predictable little problems to lengthy and stressful periods of pressure, a whole array of burdens to bear. It would be impossible to try to cope with all these situations that assail the lives of consecrated persons, but in all of them, we feel the urgent need to find a well to quench our thirst and relieve the weariness from the journey. All these situations demand, like a silent plea, a well from which we can set out once more. For some time now, a subtle weariness seems to have found a place in our communities, a weariness that has nothing to do with the Lord's weariness. It is a temptation that we might call the weariness of hope. This weariness is felt when, as in the gospel, the sun beats down mercilessly and with such intensity that it becomes impossible to keep walking or even to look ahead. Everything becomes confused. I am not referring to that particular heaviness of heart felt by those who feel shattered at the end of the day, yet manage a serene and grateful smile. I am speaking of that other weariness, which comes from looking ahead once reality hits, and calls into question the energy, resources, and viability of our mission in this changing and challenging world. This weariness paralyzes. It comes from looking ahead and not knowing how to react to the intense and confusing changes that we as a society are experiencing. These changes seem to call into question not only our ways of speaking and engaging, our attitudes and habits in dealing with reality, but in many cases they call into doubt the very viability of religious life in today's world. And the very speed of these changes can paralyze our options and opinions, while what was meaningful and important in the past can now no longer seem valid.
Hermanas y hermanos, el cansancio de la esperanza.
Brothers and sisters, the weariness of hope comes from seeing a church wounded by sin, which so often failed to hear all those cries that echoed the cry of the Master, "My God, why have you forsaken me?" We can get used to living with a weariness of hope before an uncertain and unknown future. And this can pave the way for a gray pragmatism to lodge in the heart of our communities. Everything apparently goes on as usual, but in reality, faith is crumbling and failing. Disappointed by a reality that we do not understand or that we think has no room for our message, we can open the door to one of the worst heresies possible in our time. The notion that the Lord and our communities have nothing to say or contribute to the new world now being born. What once arose to be the salt and light for the world ends up stale and worn.
Dame de beber.
Give me a drink.
Las fatigas del camino acontecen y se hacen sentir.
Weariness from the journey can happen. It can make itself felt. Like it or not, we do well to have the same courage as the Master and say, "Give me a drink," as was the case with the Samaritan woman, and perhaps with each one of us. We want to quench our thirst, not with any water, but with the spring of water welling up to eternal life. Like the Samaritan woman who for years had been carrying the empty pitchers of failed loves, we know that not just any word can help us regain energy and prophecy in our mission, not just any novelty, however alluring it may seem, can quench our thirst. We know, as she did, that neither knowledge of religion nor upholding options and traditions, past or present, always makes us fruitful and passionate worshipers in spirit and in truth. Give me a drink is what the Lord begs. He asks us to say those same words. To say them, let us open the door and let our wearied hope return without fear to the deep well of our first love, when Jesus passed our way, gazed at us with mercy, and asked us to follow him. To say those words, let us revive the memory of that moment when his eyes met ours, the moment when he made us realize that he loved us, not only personally, but also as a community.
Poder decir, dame de beber, es volver sobre nuestros pasos.
It means saying, give me a drink means retracing our steps and in creative fidelity, listening to how the Lord, how the Spirit inspired no specific works, pastoral plans, or structures, but instead, through any number of saints next door, including the founders of your institutes and the bishops and priests who laid the bases for your communities. He gave life and fresh breath to a particular moment of history when all hope and dignity seemed to be stifled and crushed. Give me a drink means finding the courage to be purified and to recapture the most authentic part of our founding charisms, which are not only for religious life, but for the life of the Church as a whole, and to see how they can find expression today. This means not only looking back on the past with gratitude, but seeking the roots of their inspiration and letting them resound forcefully once again in our midst. Give me a drink means recognizing that we need the Spirit to make us men and women mindful of a passage, the salvific passage of God, and trusting that, as he did yesterday, he will still do tomorrow. Going to the roots helps us, without a doubt, to live in the present without fear. We need to live without fear, responding to life with the passion of being engaged with history, immersed in things, with the passion of lovers.
La esperanza cansada será sanada y gozará de esa particular.
A wearied hope will be healed and will enjoy that particular tiredness of heart when it is unafraid to return to the place of its first love and to find in the peripheries and challenges before us today the same song, the same gaze that inspired the song and the gaze of those who have gone before us. In this way, we will avoid the danger of starting with ourselves. We will abandon a wearisome self-pity in order to meet Christ's gaze as he continues today to seek us, to call us, and to invite us to mission.
Como lo hizo en aquel primer encuentro, el encuentro del primer amor.
Just as he did when we first met him, when he first met us, our first love.
No me parece un acontecimiento menor.
For me, it is no small thing that this cathedral now reopens its doors after a lengthy renovation. It has experienced the passage of the years as a faithful witness of the history of this people. And now, with the help and work of many, it wants once more to show us its beauty. More than a formal restoration, which always attempts to reproduce the original appearance, this restoration has sought to preserve the beauty of the past while making room for all the newness of the present. A Spanish, Indian, and Afro-American cathedral thus becomes a Panamanian cathedral, belonging both to past generations and to those of today who made it possible. It no longer belongs only to the past. It no longer belongs only to the past, but it is a thing of beauty for the present. Today, it is once more a place of peace that encourages us to renew and nurture our hope, to discover how yesterday's beauty becomes a basis for creating the beauty of tomorrow. This is how the Lord works.
La peculiar fatiga del corazón, del que lleva adelante todos los días lo que le fue encomendado en la mirada del primer amor. Hermanos, no nos dejemos robar la esperanza.
Brothers and sisters, may we not allow ourselves to be robbed of the beauty we have inherited from our ancestors. Let it be a living and fruitful root that will help us continue to make beautiful and prophetic the history of salvation in these lands. Those present reacting to our Holy Father's homily, in which he cited numerous times from an interview he gave to Fernando Prado, which has been published in a book called The Strength of Vocation. We will now pray the creed, and the rest of the rite of the dedication of the altar will then follow.
Creo en un solo Dios, Padre Todopoderoso, Creador del cielo y de la tierra, y de todo lo visible y lo invisible. Creo en un solo Señor Jesucristo, Hijo único de Dios, nacido del Padre antes de todos los siglos. Dios de Dios, luz de luz, Dios verdadero y bueno. Señor, de la misma naturaleza del Padre, por quien todo fue hecho, y que por nosotros los hombres y por nuestra salvación bajó del cielo, y por obra del Espíritu Santo se encarnó de María la Virgen. Por nuestra causa fue crucificado en tiempo de Poncio Pilato, y fue sepultado, y resucitó al tercer día según las
y está sentado a la derecha
de y su familia no tendrá fin. Creo en el Espíritu Santo, Señor y Dador de vida, que presenta. Que nuestras plegarias, queridos hermanos, suban a Dios Padre Todopoderoso por Jesucristo, el único mediador, al cual se hayan asociado todos los santos como partícipes de su pasión.
Beloved brothers and sisters, let our prayers ascend to God, the Almighty Father, through Jesus Christ, to whom all the saints are joined as sharers in his suffering and companions at his table. Those present have been invited to kneel. And now there will be the Litany of Saints.
San Andrés. Santa María Magdalena. San Esteban, San Ignacio de Antioquía, San Lorenzo, San Ramón Nonato. Santas perpetua y felicidad. Santa Inés. San Gregorio. San Agustín. San Basilio, San Benito, Santos Francisco y Domingo. San Juan María Vianney, Santa Catalina de Siena, Santa Rita de Casia, Santa Teresa de Jesús. San Juan Bosco, Santa Rosa de Lima, San Martín de Porres, San Oscar Arnulfo Romero, Santos y Santas de Dios. Muéstrate propicio.
Lord, be merciful. Lord, deliver us, we pray, from all evil.
De la muerte eterna.
From everlasting death.
Por tu encarnación.
By your incarnation.
Por tu muerte y resurrección.
By your death and resurrection.
Por el envío del Espíritu Santo.
By the outpouring of the Holy Spirit.
Nosotros que somos pecadores.
Be merciful to us sinners. Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer. Govern and protect, keep the Pope and all the ordained in faithful service.
Para que asistas al Papa.
Govern and protect your Holy Church.
En tu servicio santo. Para que concedas paz y concordia.
Bring all peoples together in peace and true harmony.
Para que nos fortalezcas
Strengthen us and keep us in your holy service. Consecrate this altar for your worship.
Jesus,
Son of the living God, Christ, hear us. Christ, graciously hear us.
Te pedimos, Señor.
Mercifully accept our petitions, we pray, O Lord, through the intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, so that this altar may be a place where the great mysteries of salvation are accomplished, and where your people offer you gifts, make known their desires, pour out their prayers, and bring forth every sentiment of worship and devotion. The people now rise. They're now coming forward toward the altar as the ministers gather. The relic now being placed into the altar. Our Holy Father venerating the relic before placing it into the small niche. Looks like there may be more than one. Has been a custom since the very beginning of the church that altars be erected over the tombs of the saints, and this custom still carried out by placing relics of martyrs within the altar at the time of its dedication.
Te alabamos, Señor, te bendecimos, porque en tu inefable designio de amor.
And now we have the prayer of dedication. We glorify you, Lord, and we bless you, for in the ineffable sacrament of your love, you have decreed that the mystery of the altar should be brought to fulfillment in Christ, to whom all types and shadows give way. For Noah, a second father of the human race, once the flood had receded, set up an altar to you and offered a sacrifice which you, Father, accepted as a pleasing fragrance, thereby renewing your covenant of love with the human race. Abraham, our father in faith, clinging to your word with all his heart, constructed an altar so that by not sparing Isaac, his beloved son, he might be pleasing to you. Moses, too, the mediator of the old law, built an altar which, sprinkled with the blood of a lamb, would mystically prefigure the altar of the cross. All this Christ has fulfilled in the Paschal mystery, for by ascending the tree of the cross as priest and victim, he handed himself over to you, Father, as a pure oblation, so that the sins of the whole world might be blotted out and a new and eternal covenant be made with you. Therefore, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, pour forth from heaven your sanctifying power upon this altar, built in the house of the church, that it may be an altar dedicated for all time by the sacrifice of Christ, and stand as the Lord's table, where your people are refreshed by the divine banquet. Let this stone, cut and shaped, be for us a sign of Christ, from whose pierced side flowed blood and water, by which were established the sacraments of the Church. Let this be a festive table to which the guests of Christ hasten with joy, so that, casting on you their cares and burdens, they may gain new strength of spirit for new paths ahead. Let it be the place of intimate communion with you and a place of peace, where those who feed on the body and blood of your Son may be filled with his Spirit and grow in love. Let it be the source of the Church's unity and of fraternal harmony, where your faithful gathering as one may drink of the Spirit of mutual charity. Let it be the center of our praise and thanksgiving until we come jubilant to the eternal dwellings, where we are to offer you the sacrifice of unending praise with Christ the High Priest and living altar, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit.
Señor, santifique con su poder este altar que vamos.
May the Lord, by his power, sanctify this altar, which by our ministry we anoint, so that as a visible sign it may express the mystery of Christ, who offered himself to the Father for the life of the world. And at this time, the altar will be anointed with chrism. The anointing makes the altar a symbol of Christ. As we just heard in the prayer, Christ is the living altar, who before all others is and is called the Anointed One. That's what Christ means in the original Greek. For the Father anointed him with the Holy Spirit and constituted him high priest, so that on the altar of his body he might offer the sacrifice of his life for the salvation of all.
Me brota del corazón un poema bello. Recito mis versos a un rey. Mi lengua es ágil pluma de escribano. Eres el más bello de los hombres. En tus labios se derrama la gracia. Señor, te bendice eternamente. Hijas de reyes salen a tu encuentro. De pie a tu derecha está la reina, enjollada con oro. Traen entre alegría y algazara, van entrando en el palacio real. Hijas de reyes salen a tu
encuentro. As we can see, our Holy Father is now rubbing the chrism oil into the altar. Using oil to dedicate things to God has its roots in it, the Old Testament. Altars are set aside for sacrifice. And early in Christianity, the altar became representative of Christ himself, the perfect sacrifice. And so, since Christ's name means the Anointed One, it's most fitting that the altar, which is a symbol of the Anointed One par excellence, is itself anointed with oil.
Recito mis versos a un rey. Mi lengua.
The oil that's used is chrism. The local bishop consecrates this oil during the Triduum. And before it's blessed, this particular oil is mixed with balsam, which is a sweet aromatic perfume used since ancient times, possibly with a connection to Corinthians, where St. Paul refers to the fragrance of Christ that Christians have to leave wherever they go.
Las traen entre alegría y algazara. Van entrando en el palacio real. Eres el más bello de los hombres. En tus labios se derrama la gracia. Señor, te bendice eternamente. Me brota del corazón un poema bello. Recito mis versos.
Our Holy Father, who had divested of the chasuble before anointing the altar with oil, now is revested with the chasuble.
Las traen entre alegría y algazara. Van entrando en el palacio
Señor, nuestra oración, como
let our prayer rise, O Lord, like incense in your sight, and as this house is filled with a pleasing fragrance, so let your church be fragrant with the aroma of Christ. Now the incensing of the altar will take place. Incense burned on the altar to signify that Christ's sacrifice, there perpetuated in mystery, ascends to God as an odor of sweetness, and also to signify that the people's prayers rise up, pleasing and acceptable, reaching the throne of God.
Yeah.
Father himself now being incensed by the minister, and in turn the assembly. A fitting gesture that reminds us that as the Lord truly offers his sacrifice here on the altar, he also wants to be able to offer that sacrifice on the altar of our own hearts as baptized members of his body. Will now be covered, and candles will now be placed. Possibility of viewing this new altar. Fathers of the Church, we, through faith, have the certitude that Christ was the victim, priest, and altar of his own sacrifice, as we find in the letter to the Hebrews that Christ is presented as the high priest, who is also the living altar and the heavenly temple. And in the book of Revelation, our Redeemer appears as the Lamb who has been sacrificed and whose offering is taken by the holy angel to the altar in heaven. And since Christ is the head and teacher, is the true altar, his members and disciples are also spiritual altars on which the sacrifice of a holy life is offered to God. And we know in the sacrament of baptism, we too receive a new garment, symbolizing our new relationship in Christ, just as this altar is now receiving garments. We adorn the altar with cloths fitting to it. And it does seem that the fathers of the Church also had this in mind. Saint Ignatius of Antioch asked the Romans quite plainly, "Grant me only this favor. Let my blood be spilled in sacrifice to God while there is still an altar ready." And Saint Polycarp exhorted widows to lead a life of holiness, "For they are God's altar," he said. Saint Gregory the Great said something very similar when he said, "What is God's altar if not the souls of those who lead good lives?" Rightly then, the heart of the just is said to be the altar of God. And in another image that's often used by writers in the Church, Christians who give themselves to prayer, who offer intercession for their brothers and sisters, and present sacrifices of supplication are the living stones out of which the Lord Jesus builds the church's altar.
La luz de Cristo ilumine la mesa del altar.
May the light of Christ shine upon the table of this altar, and may those who share the Lord's Supper shine with his light. The candles will now be lit by the deacon. The lighting of the altar teaches us that Christ is a light to enlighten the nations. His brightness shines out in the church and through it to the entire human family. We see different ministers have different functions in this rite, a reminder that all of us priests and people gather around the one altar on which the Eucharistic sacrifice is offered, but each with a different function. We celebrate the memorial of Christ's death and resurrection, and we partake in the banquet that he prepares for us. And so the altar has been prepared as the table of a spiritual banquet, as adorned for a feast. Thus the dressing and the candles on the altar signify that this is the Lord's table at which he invites all of us to dine. He wants to refresh us with divine food, namely his body and blood sacrificed for us on the altar of the cross. Offertory procession. It is the Archbishop of Panama who receives the gifts, for as we heard, since his cathedral has been under construction, he had no place in which to receive these gifts. Now he does so again with the reopening and rededication of this altar, for it is only now that the sacrifice of the Mass can be offered on this altar, now that it has been dedicated, set apart, to have only one use. It's not something that we can just set things down on. No, this has one use. This is the table of the Lord. It is something sacred. And so we continue with the liturgy of the Eucharist now. This table, as at every other altar throughout the world, representing Christ the Lord, acting in His name, truly accomplishes what the Lord Himself did and what He handed on to His apostles to do in His memory. The first account we have of this is through the Apostle Paul when he says, "The blessing cup that we bless is a communion with the blood of Christ, and the bread that we break is a communion with the body of Christ." The fact that there is only one loaf means that though there are many of us, we form a single body because we have a share in that one loaf.
Oren, hermanos, para que este sacrificio mío y de ustedes sea agradable a Dios Padre Todopoderoso. Te rogamos, Señor Dios nuestro, que descienda tu Espíritu Santo.
May your Holy Spirit come down upon this altar, we pray, O Lord our God, to sanctify the gifts of your people and graciously to cleanse the hearts of all who receive them.
El Señor esté con ustedes. Levantemos el corazón. Demos gracias al Señor nuestro Dios. En verdad es justo y necesario.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. Having become both the true priest and the true oblation, He has taught us to celebrate forever the memorial of the sacrifice that He Himself offered to you on the altar of the cross. Therefore, Lord, your people have raised this altar, which we dedicate to you with joyful praise. Truly, this is an exalted place where the sacrifice of Christ is ever offered in mystery, where perfect praise is rendered to you and redemption flows forth for us. Here is prepared the table of the Lord, where your children, fed by the body of Christ, are gathered into the one holy church. Here, the faithful drink of your Spirit from the streams that flow from Christ, the spiritual rock, through whom they too become a holy oblation, a living altar. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks as in exaltation we acclaim.
Oh,
The Eucharistic prayer is number 3.
Ya que por Jesucristo, tu Hijo, Señor nuestro, y con la fuerza del Espíritu Santo, das vida y santificas todo, y congregas a tu pueblo sin cesar, para que ofrezca en tu honor un sacrificio sin mancha, desde donde sale el sol hasta el ocaso. Por eso, Padre, te suplicamos que santifiques por el mismo Espíritu estos dones que hemos separado para ti, de manera que se conviertan en el cuerpo y la sangre de Jesucristo, Hijo tuyo y Señor nuestro, que nos mandó celebrar este misterio. Porque él mismo, la noche en que iba a ser entregado, tomó pan y, dando gracias, te bendijo, lo partió y lo dio a sus discípulos diciendo: tomen y coman todos de él, porque esto es mi cuerpo, que será entregado por ustedes. Del mismo modo, acabada la cena, tomó el cáliz. Dando gracias, te bendijo y lo pasó a sus discípulos diciendo: tomen y beban todos de él, porque este es el cáliz de mi sangre, sangre de la alianza nueva y eterna, que será derramada por ustedes y por muchos para el perdón de los pecados. Hagan esto en conmemoración mía. Este es el sacramento de nuestra fe. Así pues, Padre, al celebrar ahora el memorial de la pasión salvadora de tu Hijo, de su admirable resurrección y ascensión al cielo, mientras esperamos su venida gloriosa, te ofrecemos en esta acción de gracias el sacrificio vivo y santo. Dirige tu mirada sobre la ofrenda de tu Iglesia y reconoce en ella la víctima por cuya inmolación quisiste devolvernos tu amistad, para que, fortalecidos con el cuerpo y la sangre de tu Hijo y llenos de su Espíritu Santo, formemos en Cristo un solo cuerpo y un solo Espíritu.
Que Él nos transforme en ofrenda permanente, para que gocemos de tu heredad junto con tus elegidos, con María la Virgen, Madre de Dios, su esposo San José, los apóstoles y los mártires, y todos los santos por cuya intercesión confiamos obtener siempre tu ayuda.
Te pedimos, Padre, que esta víctima de reconciliación traiga la paz y la salvación al mundo entero. Confirma en la fe y en la caridad a tu Iglesia peregrina en la tierra, a tu servidor, el Papa Francisco, a mi hermano José Domingo, obispo de esta Iglesia, a mí, indigno siervo tuyo, al orden episcopal, a los presbíteros y diáconos, y a todo el pueblo redimido por ti. Atiende los deseos y súplicas de esta familia que has congregado en tu presencia. Reúne en torno a ti, Padre misericordioso, a todos tus hijos dispersos por el mundo, a nuestros hermanos difuntos y a cuantos murieron en tu amistad. Recíbelos en tu reino, donde esperamos gozar todos juntos de la plenitud eterna de tu gloria. Por Cristo Señor nuestro, por quien concedes al mundo todos los bienes.
Por Cristo, con Él y en Él, a ti Dios Padre Omnipotente, en la unidad del Espíritu Santo, todo honor y toda gloria por los siglos de los siglos.
We are now invited to pray the Lord's Prayer.
El amor de Dios ha sido derramado en nuestros corazones con el Espíritu Santo que se nos ha dado. Digamos con fe y esperanza. Padre nuestro que estás en el cielo,
santificado sea tu nombre. Venga a nosotros tu reino. Hágase tu voluntad en la tierra como en el cielo. Danos hoy nuestro pan de cada día. Perdona nuestras ofensas, como también nosotros perdonamos a los que nos ofenden. No nos dejes caer en la tentación y líbranos del mal.
Líbranos de todos los males, Señor. Concédenos la paz en nuestros días, para que, ayudados por tu misericordia, vivamos siempre libres de pecado y protegidos de toda perturbación, mientras esperamos la gloriosa venida de nuestro Salvador Jesucristo. Señor Jesucristo, que dijiste a tus apóstoles, la paz les dejo, mi paz les doy. No tengas en cuenta nuestros pecados, sino la fe de tu Iglesia. Y conforme a tu palabra, concédele la paz y la unidad. Tú que vives y reinas por los siglos de los siglos.
Amén.
La paz del Señor esté siempre con ustedes.
Y con
como hijo de Dios, intercambien ahora un signo de comunión fraterna.
And we've been invited as the children of God to exchange now a sign of fraternal communion. So we might exchange that sign with those with whom right now we find ourselves. Here we see the many more who have gathered outside of the cathedral in order to participate in this Mass with the Holy Father. Holy Father also exchanging the sign of peace with a representative of an ecumenical representative. Exchanging a sign of peace with the President of the Republic of Panama. And now returns to the altar.
Cordero de Dios, que quita el pecado del mundo. Dichosos los invitados a la cena del Señor.
Present now receiving the blood, body and blood of Jesus Christ, which has now been consecrated on this altar for the first time. Of the dedication of an altar is a very rare rite which takes place. So we've been blessed to be able to participate in this rich celebration today, being reminded also of our own participation in the mystery we have been witness to today. For it is also a reminder that the children of the church, those of us who have been baptized into Christ, have the power to celebrate the memorial of Christ and to take our place at the Lord's table. This is something new with Christianity. Prior to that, only priests offered the sacrifice, and no one else was present. But because of our participation in the mystery of Christ and his presence within us, we too participate in the sacrifice that he renews. Many altars, as we said, have relics or the body of a saint. But the dignity of the altar does not rest on the honor that the martyr's body gives to it, but on the fact that it is the table of the Lord. The altar does honor to the martyr's tomb, not the other way around. The church teaches it is altogether proper to construct altars over the burial place of martyrs and other saints, or to deposit their relics within or beneath an altar as a mark of respect and as a symbol of the truth that the sacrifice of the members has its source in the sacrifice of Christ. Thus, those who have been triumphant come to their rest in the place where Christ is victim. He who suffered for us is placed on the altar, on top of the altar, where those who have been redeemed by his sufferings are beneath, always beneath. Once again, see here imitated what we read in the book of Revelation. I saw underneath the altar the souls of all the people who have been killed on account of the word of God. Those who are assembled here, continuing to receive our Lord in Holy Communion,
oremos. Concédenos, Señor, reunirnos siempre en torno a tus.
Keep us, O Lord, ever close to your altar, where the sacrament of sacrifice is celebrated, so that united in faith and charity, we who by Christ are nourished into Christ may be transformed, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Santo Padre, hoy abrimos una nueva página en la historia del pueblo de Dios en Panamá.
Holy Father, today we turn a new page in the history of the people of God in Panama. In this cathedral basilica, dedicated to Santa María la Antigua.
Humilde y sencilla, en la casa rancho del cacique Sémaco. La Iglesia Católica en Panamá ha entretejido su historia.
The history of the Catholic Church in Panama is woven into that of the history of the people. And this church has witnessed this journey in which there have been many joys and sorrows, but above all, hope as well. As successors of the apostles in communion with the Vicar of Christ, we are convinced and committed to accompanying you in this process of conversion, which the Church needs in order to recuperate the image of the authentic Church of Jesus Christ, a merciful Church, one that draws near, is welcoming, is servant, is poor on behalf of the poor, so as to be a house of welcome and communion for everyone, without excluding anyone. We trust in the promise of our Lord Jesus Christ when he said, "And I say to you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." In this cathedral, Basilica of Santa Maria la Antigua, the Catholic Church is present, an expression of a people who received the faith 505 years ago from the hands of the Virgin Mary. This is the faith that we all want to renew before the successor of Peter, Vicar of Christ, in order to say, like Mary, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be done to me according to your word." Holy Father, you are not alone in this process of renewal and conversion. You can count on our fidelity and on our prayers. We are a church that walks with hope, hand in hand with Mary, under the title of Santa María la Antigua. In the name of this Panamanian church, we want to offer you an image of the servant of God.
Y San Juan Pablo II iniciaron estas jornadas mundiales de la juventud.
Who, along with Pope John Paul II, initiated the World Youth Day. So he's presenting him with an image. I didn't catch the name, but it seems with another person who, with John Paul II, initiated World Youth Day. The words we just heard were from the Archbishop of Panama, Jose Domingo Ulloa.
Señor, esté con ustedes.
Inclinen la cabeza para recibir la bendición.
Que Dios, que nos ha enriquecido con el sacerdocio real, les conceda que cumpliendo santamente sus deberes puedan participar dignamente en el sacrificio de Cristo.
Amén. Que Él, que nos congrega en torno a una sola mesa y nos alimenta con un solo pan, les conceda tener un solo corazón y una sola alma.
Amén.
Para que con el ejemplo del amor fraterno atraigan a Cristo a aquellos a quienes ustedes les anuncian el Evangelio.
Amén.
La bendición de Dios Todopoderoso, Padre, el Hijo y del Espíritu Santo, descienda sobre ustedes y permanezca para siempre.
La alegría del Señor sea nuestra fuerza, pueden ir en paz.
those who concelebrated and were the ministers for this celebration, now taking their leave of the altar. The name Santa Maria la Antigua also has roots to Rome, because there is a church with that name in the Roman Forum. This ends now the live broadcast of the liturgy celebrated by Pope Francis in the Cathedral Basilica of Santa Maria la Antigua with priests, religious, and members of lay movements. Pope Francis will now go to St. Joseph Major Seminary, where he will eat lunch with the seminarians, and later this evening he will take part in the World Youth Day Vigil in Metro Park, which has been renamed St. John Paul II Field. For complete coverage of World Youth Day, be sure to visit the Vatican News web portal, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. You can find us on YouTube as well. On behalf of Vatican Media, thank you all for joining us. We'll be back again later today with more live coverage of the 34th World Youth Day taking place in Panama. Laudetur Jesus Christus. Praised be Jesus Christ.